You might think that over the last couple of decades, production patterns and consumption choices have become much more sustainable. Take for instance today's LEDs, which use 10 times less energy than old incandescent light bulbs, or flat screen TVs, which are much more efficient than the clunky cathode ray tube you might know from your grandparents' house, or cars, which are now more aerodynamic, lightweight, and have more fuel efficient engines than back in the 1990s. There are many more examples of products that have become more efficient in recent years. With all these innovations, surely the environmental impact of air consumption has gone down, right? The answer is no. Despite all these improvements, air consumption and production patterns have overall become less sustainable. But why? The answer is complex, but has a lot to do with what's called the rebound effect. Basically, what happens is that an increase in technology efficiency may drive increase in consumption. Improvements in production patterns have made many products like cars and TVs more efficient and often cheaper too. And in response to this, we have been consuming them a lot more. Instead of one light bulb, we are now using multiple LEDs and in more places. New TVs are becoming larger and larger. And making cars more fuel efficient allowed people to trade in their smaller cars for larger SUV type models and made the smaller ones affordable for people who previously did not even own a car. As a result, roads are becoming more congested, making our commute even less sustainable. A rebound effect like this wipes out all of our gains in eco-efficiency. Hi, my name is Sami Kara, and I'm a professor of sustainable manufacturing and lifecycle engineering at the University of New South Wales School of Mechanical and Manufacturing Engineering. Sustainable development must consider environment, society, and economy all at the same time. The well-known IPED equation supports an analysis of the challenge that central driving forces pose to the development of sustainable production and consumption patterns. It presents the total environmental impact I as a function of the central drivers represented by human population P, human effluence A, which can be interpreted here as a shorthand for consumption, and the technology factor T, which can equate to here with production patterns. To get an idea of how challenging it is to ensure environmental sustainability, consider the following conditions for a sustainable climate change impact I in 2050. According to the IPCC, we need to reduce our greenhouse gases emission in 2050 by up to 70% of the current level to have a reasonable probability to stay below the 2-degree limits for global temperature rise set by the Paris Agreement. Meanwhile, the global production P is predicted to increase by a factor of 1.4 to reach 9.75 billion in 2050. Average effluence A, and therefore consumption 2, is expected to increase worldwide thanks to the economic growth of developing nations, and here a factor 2 seems to be a conservative estimate. To achieve a 70% reduction in impact I, the technology factor T has to compensate the increase in P and A, so the T needs to decrease by a factor close to 10. It's important to remember that the factors in IPED equation are not independent. Consumption and production, or affluence and technology, often go hand in hand. And as the examples of LEDs, TVs, and cars illustrate, they can create a rebound effect in which major improvements in efficiency are outweighed by major increase in consumption. SDG 12 specifically addresses responsible consumption and production and aims to ensure sustainable consumption production patterns with some of the targets concerning sustainable management and efficient use of natural resources, halving of food waste, waste reduction through prevention, reduction, recycling and reuse, environmentally sound management of chemicals, dissemination of information about company practices that support sustainable procurement and consumption. Irrespective of the product or the industry, an important tool in understanding responsible consumption and production is lifecycle thinking. Because it's not enough to develop solutions for environmentally friendly end-of-life management of products such as recycling. Products provide functions by using back and foreground systems. foreground systems are those systems specific for the operation of the product along its life cycle. In contrast, background systems are generic. They support the operation of the foreground system, but are not specific to that product. Let's take electric cars as an example. In the foreground system, there's the entire life cycle of the electric vehicles, from materials, manufacturing, use, to end of life. In the background system, there is energy, electricity, or other form used throughout the electric vehicle's life cycle. Although energy is critical for the operation of the electric vehicle foreground system, it's also generic and used by other product systems such as TVs, houses, etc. When we think about sustainability of electric vehicles, we need to consider not only the foreground system, but also how the foreground system interacts with the background system. In the electric vehicle case, the foreground system can have a lower environmental footprint. However, if the supporting background system relies heavily on fossil fuels, then the environmental impact shifts from tailpipe emission to upstream energy supply. Similar examples can be found in other product systems, as simple as beverages, plastic bottles, such as Coke and Pepsi. In this case, the main attention has always been on the beverage container and how they should be treated. In reality, the environmental impact hotspot is in the farming of the corn syrup used for making the beverage, which is in the background system. But a life cycle perspective is not enough to achieve SDG 12 because it ultimately assumes that consumption and production are independent, which is rarely the case. Remember the rebound effect? A strong increase in the eco-efficiency of the products and technologies is clearly needed to ensure a sustainable level of environmental impact. But examples like LEDs, TVs, and cars illustrate that a focus on eco-efficiency alone is not enough to ensure sustainable consumption and production in the future. There's a need to analyze the overall outcome in terms of environmental impact for a product or technology and relate it to the share of the operating space that this product or technology can claim, considering the size of its market, to ensure that the improvements lead to the solution that are not just more sustainable than what they replace, but sustainable in absolute terms. Solutions then might be to develop products never to be discarded, or to provide the service without having to own the product. The point is this: technology alone cannot achieve the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals without considering society and its ever-increasing affluence. As the rebound effect shows, we are not only need environmental-friendly production patterns, we also need to rethink consumption. So the buck stops with you. Think about your own consumption patterns. Try to gain a life cycle perspective and ask yourself, what are the environmental impact hotspots in the product and services you consume? Are there better alternatives to these products? And most importantly, do you really need them?